What's up, party people? I'm about to get started. Yeah, I'm sitting in the closet. But who cares? You're going to learn some stuff today. So I'm Mike King. Problem is I'm going to be sharing my screen here and I'm not going to be able to see what everyone else is saying. So once we get into the Q&A section, I'll be able to engage everybody that's on screen. So first of all, thanks everybody for joining us today. I'm excited to share some things with y'all. So if you don't mind, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And my apologies if there's any sounds that you hear in the background. This is what modern pandemic co-working is like in the house. So in the meantime, how's everybody doing out there? Oh, I can still see y'all. Great. Thanks, Bobby. You're like the one guy in the crowd that, you know, is like, yeah, when somebody says make some noise. All right. So I'm hoping y'all can see my screen. If not, somebody on my team, please send me an email because I can see that on my phone. My Slack messages are otherwise shut down for right now. So cool. We're going to jump into the essentials of modern enterprise SEO today, and I'm very excited to see y'all here. First, me, I'm Mike King. I'm not going to sit here and give you a big bio on myself. I'm just going to tell you that I worked on a lot of enterprise brands when it comes to SEO. So as of yesterday, iPullRank is 6 years old. Super excited about that. And yeah, I wrote a blog post that I published on my Twitter and on Medium and so on that just talks about things that we've learned in the last 6 years. So just some real quick who we are for anyone that doesn't know. You know, we're based in New York City. We're 6 years old as of yesterday. We've got 15 employees. We're founded by me. We also got a network of 100 plus content creators that are subject matter experts. And the most important thing is the thing that I did not cover here. It's the fact that we have driven over $1 billion in incremental revenue for our clients. So that really comes from, you know, just 6 years. Well, we discovered that last year, but 6 years of working with a lot of enterprise brands and, you know, being impactful on some pretty big businesses. So our agenda for today, I'm going to talk a bit about the state of enterprise SEO. We're going to talk about some of the key winners in enterprise SEO, and then we're going to get into some of the core and common problems and solutions that we see with enterprise SEO. Then we'll talk a bit about how we approach it at iPullRank so you can take away some of the things that we do and use it in your day-to-day. And then also some strategies and tactics that you should consider if you haven't already. And then a word from our sponsor, then we'll open it up for Q&A and I'll be able to see y'all again. Cool. So the state of enterprise SEO. First, what makes a company enterprise? You know, I mean, we've got a definition in the Modern Enterprise SEO ebook that we created, but I think it really comes down to the size of the business, right? Like you've got businesses that make over, I think it's something like $100 million are considered enterprise businesses. But when we talk about enterprise SEO, it doesn't necessarily mean the business size. It can mean the business size, like the number of people in the business and how much money that business makes, but it also can speak to the business's structure. If they're oriented in lines of business, the approach for SEO will be different as a result of that. So if you're dealing with a variety of different stakeholders that sit in one silo around one core type of the business, then you're probably dealing with an enterprise SEO situation. And also, if the site is super big, so I say that because, you know, the tool set that you're going to need to use will be enterprise if you're talking about, you know, a site that has billions or hundreds of millions of pages. So when we're talking about enterprise SEO, it's one of those three things that basically puts you in a different set of strategies and tactics than if you're just doing SMB SEO. So how does that differ between doing SMB SEO? It's largely that you're going to have to deal with recommendations that can scale. And it's also about navigating different organizations. And we're going to talk a lot about what is required for those different things, but it's not about doing the cutting edge stuff. It's more about like, how do you get people to do the basic stuff? And those basic things tend to have a large impact when you're doing enterprise SEO. So for the enterprise, we can't just, you know, do SEO in isolation. You have to make it fit in with the marketing mix. And we very much think about the digital marketing funnel and how SEO has to play with different channels when you're doing enterprise SEO. So more often than not, you're having to discuss with what social is doing. You're having to discuss with what the CRO people are doing. The different teams are involved doing different things, and you've got to bring that alignment. And that can be, you know, SEO is more of a strategic channel, saying like, here's what people want, so let's align everybody on all the channels as a result of that. Or it can be kind of a reactive channel, like, okay, all these other channels are doing things. How do we make sure we're getting the most out of these channels? But the bottom line is, if you look at the funnel, SEO fits in every place, whereas something like display may or may not fit at different stages of the journey and so on. And so you got to figure out the best way to have that interplay with those different channels, and don't come in and just like blow things up because, you know, SEO needs certain considerations. And so with enterprise, it's very important to be able to forecast your ROI. And the mechanisms around that haven't really changed as far as like what the equation is. It's still a function of CTR versus search volume versus conversion rate and average order value, if that's relevant to this enterprise. That could also be mean, you know, the value of a lead, or it can also mean like how much traffic can we drive that we can get, then convert into ad impressions. So there's a wide variety of ways that you can determine what the actual value is, but the amount of potential traffic is still calculated in the same way. And so the only other thing to think about really is that if you want more accurate projections, you should do it on the back of A/B testing for SEO. So, you know, I can sit here and say like, oh yeah, we're gonna do this one tactic and we expect a 10% lift, but there's really no way to know that. The best way to do it is to take some portion of your site and split it out, and then from there, you know, see how that performs, and then you can project how that'll perform across the entirety of the site to get a more accurate forecast of ROI. Because otherwise, you know, you can't really account for what search engines might do algorithmically and what and when they may pick things up. So it's very difficult to say like, you know, in 30 days, we're gonna get X from this effort. The thing is that enterprise brands don't really like to wait for that type of return, because the reality of it is when you're doing SEO, it's a compounding return. You know, the more content you put out, more content you optimize, the more links that you get pointing back to that content, the more you're going to get value out of SEO. So it tends to roll upwards if you're doing it well. And so, you know, I love this comparison of content marketing versus paid search, because a lot of people, especially on the enterprise, are more oriented to the paid media channels because that's what they know from advertising and so on. And so they expect that direct response, like put in $5, you get $20 out. But that's not necessarily how organic search or content marketing works. So what you see is if you compare these types of channels, that, you know, content marketing and then ultimately SEO as a component of content marketing tends to yield more over time, but the enterprise doesn't really like to wait for that. And another thing is that in the enterprise, I mean, just like any other site, whether it's small business, mid-market, or whatever, you are having to navigate these algorithm updates. And in the enterprise, it more acts as a way to catapult you forward to doing something that you had already planned. You know, I remember when I worked on a brand called LG, the TV company, or, you know, electronics company, I had to do this really robust audit and nobody did anything. Nobody wanted to move on it. They're just like, cool, we did SEO, you did your audit, that's it. But then the first iteration of Panda rolled out and suddenly they were like, oh no, we're losing all our traffic. What do we do? And everything that I had said to do in our audit, suddenly they started doing. So in the enterprise, it's more that the algorithm updates give you the opportunity to do the things that you already wanted to do or forces you to prioritize things that you may not have prioritized before. It's not so much that it makes you do things that are completely net new. And another core point to make here is that it doesn't take Google 6 months to understand an enterprise site, even though whenever you go into an enterprise engagement, you're like, oh, we need a minimum of 6 months here. No, it takes 6 months at minimum for a big enterprise to actually execute on something. Google is very fast at this point. They can ingest your new content and recrawl you, you know, near immediately. Those changes don't necessarily take effect like the day that they're crawled, but it doesn't take 6 months, you know? So it's really like, how do you orient within a large organization to make these things happen? So when you're doing enterprise SEO, you know, the tool set is of course the same, except you're going more upstream, looking at things like, you know, Conductor and search metrics and so on. From my perspective, these are the tools that you should be using, the ones that you're seeing on the screen right here. You know, there's a lot of value that you get out of a tool like Botify, which really allows you to crawl at scale. But at some point, you may also want to crawl to a smaller crawl with Screaming Frog. A lot of enterprise brands may be using like Adobe Analytics or some other analytics package. You're inherently at a disadvantage if you do that, because Google gives you audience data and they also have a fairly robust Search Console integration. And then there are people that are doing really cool things with Google Tag Manager as far as like split testing and injecting rel canonical tags and things like that. And Google is getting more and more adherent to those things. And initially when you rolled out stuff like that using GTM, it didn't work as well. And then with the link indices, you know, I think there's value in having all of them, but if you can only go with one, I would say Ahrefs, but I would definitely recommend using Majestic and Ahrefs because of the fact that they crawl different pockets of the web. And when you're working in an enterprise, you want to have as, you know, conclusive data as possible, because you got to make business cases and so on. And then SEMrush is of course incredibly valuable just from their general data set and all the things that they have that are available that, you know, go back historically as far as rankings and all that other stuff. So let's talk about some key winners in enterprise SEO. And the main point that I want to make in this section is that Google does have a bias towards brands. So 10 years ago, anyone could rank number one for anything. And that's not to say that that's not true right now, but Google definitely biases towards brands and brand signals. There's a famous quote from Eric Schmidt where he says, basically that the internet is a cesspool and brands are the solution, not the problem. Brands are how you sort out the cesspool. So suffice to say that if you are an enterprise brand and you're contributing all the right signals, it is very likely that you are going to be one, two, and three if you're doing SEO right. So every vertical has probably one to two enterprise sites that just dominate. You know, if you're thinking of like the Amazons, the Wayfairs, the eBays, you find that they rank for everything in a given space. So I just wanted to dig into that a bit, because a lot of these sites often are not doing what we call SEO best practices. You know, a lot of these sites are really highlighting duplicate content. And so if I was to do an audit, you know, the first thing I would say is like, hey, you guys should get rid of this duplicate content. But there are so many instances where we look at these sites and the duplicate content is driving 80% of their traffic. So it's very important for you to take a look at what's going on with these sites in your space and see what the edge is as far as what you can do in SEO. You can't just rely on best practices. You really got to test and see what's going to work for you. So I just wanted to dig into some of these different sites and some of the tactics that they leverage. You know, if you look at Amazon, they rank top three for most things, right? Like most generic high-level terms. And you can really dig into it and see that they effectively create a category page for any of those like highly searched terms. And this is a tactic that we see pretty heavily across a lot of e-commerce sites, you know, where they will leverage the internal search data to create landing pages, and those landing pages will be nothing but those products. But in the case of Amazon, they've got such rich data in that they've got, you know, a lot of reviews that they can put on these pages and so on. So these pages can be very robust and have, of course, a lot of structured data on them. And then the wealth of link equity that Amazon has, pretty much anything you put on that site, it's going to rank well. Bankrate, I think they do a really good job as far as like how they capture featured snippets. So, you know, it's very often that you, especially in the financial services space, that sites want to create glossaries. And I think Bankrate does a magnificent job of it in that they have on their glossary pages, they have, you know, a short description of whatever the definition is to capture the featured snippet. And so if you look at every single, and I don't want to say every single, if you look at a lot of their glossary pages and whatever that query is. So in this case, we've got average daily balance. That short paragraph in the beginning is the featured snippet. And then under that, they've got the deeper definition to create more relevance around that query. And so they are pretty much dominating a lot of their broader definition terms and driving a lot of traffic from there. Bankrate, you know, completely dominates the financial services space. And a second, you know, runner up would be Nerdwallet, who does a really good job of the same. But what they're doing in this specific tactic that we're showing here is they've got a lot of content around best keyword terms. And so in the enterprise space, it's actually kind of difficult to target best terms because that falls under like a legal and compliance thing around advertising. To say that you're the best of something, you have to have a third party verify it. So a lot of brands can't really target best keywords, whereas a brand like Nerdwallet or Bankrate is more positioned to do that because they have more editorial content. They're not a brand saying that they're the best. They're highlighting the best of things. And they do this very well. And then you got Home Depot. What they do really well is their local landing page content. They've got their store detail pages that are so robust. They really speak to that area, what's going on in that area. They speak to, you know, what's happening at that location. Whereas in most cases, people don't do this level of detail on their location pages. And I really can't think of off the top of my head of a website that does these better than Home Depot. So I definitely say, you know, check these out, especially if you're in this space. This is the site to beat when it comes to location pages. And then Zillow, you know, Zillow has been crushing SEO forever, right? Like they have so many different permutations of the page types, whether that's like apartment targeted keywords or housing, like buying a home and so on. They target on the state level, they target on the zip code level, like all the different permutations possible. And in some cases, they may also go after amenities and so on. And again, this would technically be considered duplicate content. Like you just have all these different combinations of the same content over and over with some copy that's specific to that area or whatever. And if you are asking most SEOs, they'd be like, hey, that doesn't work. But it actually works really well for enterprise sites. And then TripAdvisor, their approach is a bit different in that their content is largely UGC, you know, leveraging the content that is being collected from the users that are going to these places and so on. TripAdvisor is one of those teams that, you know, is like kind of legendary in the space for being so good at SEO. As far as I understand it, they have a really robust data set where internally they're able to cross-tabulate any data point about the site from an SEO perspective or any other perspective that they want to see what is actually impacting things. And, you know, they, if I remember correctly, they were one of the teams at the bleeding edge of testing around like widget link building and so on. And what they realized is that, you know, the only way to do it at scale and not worry about it being a problem is to build those links without anchor text in those widgets and so on. So my point here is that, you know, TripAdvisor is thinking about everything that you should be thinking about if you're in the travel space, and I know if you're in the travel space, you're definitely having a hard time right now, but the TripAdvisor team is the one to watch as far as how to do this effectively. And then if we look at the health space, Healthline, you know, they rank for everything health related. And of course, Google came into the space in a strong way where they have content that they've created that appears in the SERPs now. And I don't personally know how that's impacted Healthline, but they have content for anything that you can think of around an ailment. They have a lot of that, what you call your money, your life content. And they have, you know, a way to really indicate that it's evidence-based so that they're sending signals to users that this is content that, you know, you should read and it is relevant and it is valuable for you to check out. And, you know, they also are leveraging like actual doctors and so on to write this stuff, which is really important because there are so many people that are just SEO copywriters that have been the ones that write about these health related topics, which is why Google came into the space and you have those knowledge cards around this stuff. But suffice to say, what Healthline does is really invest in content. And that's an incredibly important thing to do just in general for SEO. But for enterprise SEO, like it really goes a long way. Indeed, they dominate, you know, the job market searches and so on. And again, it's a very similar approach in that they have, you know, a landing page for everything. And again, that could be considered completely duplicate content, but it obviously works really well. They came into the space really optimized, killed Monster and Career Builder and all those other websites because their SEO focus is so strong. And so not only do they rank for the combinations of, you know, job type and place, but they also rank for types of jobs and so on. So it's very similar to the approach that we talked about with Zillow, where they take all the different permutations of things and then create a page for it. Then eBay, I mean, they invented a lot of what we think of when we think of enterprise SEO. One of the tactics that I talk about a lot is their programmatic internal link building that they do based on rankings. But beyond that, they also are very strong at, you know, creating very robust category layer content. But what we're highlighting here in these screenshots is how they're injecting those internal links in a relevant way and that you may also like and so on. And most e-commerce sites do approach things this way, but they're not doing the programmatic approach that eBay takes so that they're reactive to where they currently rank. Yelp, obviously dominant around all things local. And the way that they really focused on that is having those near me modifiers. So any near me, you know, query, Yelp is there. And so what they do is they have the landing pages around these different, you know, locations and such. Even if they're not a part of the Yelp network, they went out and grabbed all the location data and they created landing pages for every restaurant, every, you know, shoe store, every whatever. And then they also have the permutations around the locations and their zip codes and so on. And again, it would potentially be considered a lot of duplicate content because they're pulling this stuff from a lot of different places. It's not just things that users have contributed. But they do a really good job at targeting those near me terms. And then just the fact that they have so much link equity and authority, they're ranking for pretty much everything. So again, if you are working in the enterprise, you know, like, okay, I'm in e-commerce, it's these sites. I'm in, you know, fashion, it's these sites. There are always a few sites that are very dominant. There's always so much that you can learn from those sites because it tells you like where the best practices end. And it also tells you, okay, what should I be targeting based on what these people are targeting? Well, let's jump into some of these common problems and solutions. So a big problem that you're going to run into with enterprise SEO is having so many different CMSs that are in play. It can be, you know, you working with a CMS that you're not so familiar with. So it may be something like AEM, which a lot of enterprises are using. It could be something like that's .NET based, like Sitefinity or Contigo or something like that. Or if you're lucky, you know, it could be a WordPress. But inherently, some of these CMSs are not that bad because a lot of CMSs do have SEO capabilities or plugins or what have you. The bigger problem is when a site is built using a variety of CMSs, and it could be a CMS that like someone doesn't really have access to, or one that is like very kind of like archaic or unknown or whatever. And then you got to figure out, where does one CMS end and another one begin? We have one client that has their site, you know, some subdomains will be hosted here, some will be on this CMS with these structures. And so something simple like updating the navigation has to go through four or five different parties so that we can have consistent navigation across the entirety of the website. So understanding how to navigate that is one of the bigger problems. And then there's legal compliance. So when you're dealing with enterprise SEO, there's a whole lot of different layers of compliance. It can just be, you know, we're not allowed to talk about these things in such ways. We're not allowed to target certain keywords. We're not allowed to, you know, even be in a SERP for some of these concepts. And so that's going to directly impact everything that you do and what you're capable of doing. One of the bigger problems that comes from that legal compliance is that the speed to deployment is so difficult. I've worked a lot in the pharma space, and it can take 3 months just to change a title tag. So it's very difficult for you if there's like a new piece of news that we want to capitalize on with a piece of content, it's very difficult to get that out quickly. And you've got to put systems in place and understand what the systems are in existence within the organization in order to navigate that effectively. And then you got to understand how to work across a variety of departments. So again, you know, especially if you're working in an organization that is line of business oriented, there's just so many different parties that you need to meet and talk to just to push anything through. And that can be very difficult when you don't have a complete lay of the land. So you can be working on something, someone else could actually be working on it as well, and then you've got to like come together and put those things together and make them work. Or your whole idea could just be squashed because someone else is working on it. Or it could be the type of thing where you've worked on a project, you've gotten it so far down the line, and it's like, oh yeah, this random person that sits in an office in Dubai or something like that has to weigh in on this. And it's not something that you're going to know about in advance. So it's very important for you to sit with all your partners and figure out who the key people are that you need to engage with to get anything done. So some common challenges here. One problem, you know, a lot of organizations end up with the wrong tools. Because some companies that do SEO tooling are aligned with, you know, how enterprise organizations work. So they have really good structured sales teams, people that they hire from like a Salesforce or Google or whatever, that are really good at selling, but their product is terrible. So the way you get around that is you need to identify the core features of whatever the different tool is and tie it to the needs across the organization. So as an example, you know, Botify is great because it allows you to surface log files in addition to the things that you're doing. There's a lot of teams across an organization that can benefit from direct access to log file intelligence. And so you can bring that as a business case, like, oh, well, we're using such and such, it doesn't do this, and Botify can do this, and these four groups need this thing. And then the other thing you can do is you can tell that vendor. So let's say you're going to, you know, someone you want to switch to, and the issue there is price. If you go to that vendor and say like, hey, we really want to get off of this tool and get onto your tool, and, you know, we're spending this amount of money, they may take that short for a year just so they can get you to switch. Now that price may go back up to whatever it normally is in year two. But at that point, you will have enough of an opportunity to show the value of that tool that people will continue to use it. Another problem is you can't build links because of legal compliance, and you can't do outreach, and you can't really deploy content. So what do you do? And this is a really common one that you run into, especially for financial services, for pharma clients, and so on. But what you can do there is buy websites. So look for websites that have a lot of link equity pointing to them, ideally relevant websites that are talking about very specific subjects that you're also talking about, and then redirect those sites once you've bought them to your site. But you've got to do this in a very surgical way. You can't just do like a broad redirect of domain to domain. You've got to find the parity between pages so that Google believes in the value of forwarding that link actually. And so we've done this a lot. You know, this is an example of a site that we did this for where they were trying to rank for Christmas card queries and also wedding invitations. And, you know, the reason why this tactic even came back up at that point was they had engaged us in a really short time window. And so they were like, hey, you know, we know we're starting late, but we've got to rank better. And they had also been doing some pretty spammy link building around their Christmas cards keyword. And it was like bouncing back and forth from, you know, not ranking in the top 100 to ranking 50 and then not ranking again. And so we did some cleanup there. And then we also redirected some domains that we acquired in addition to building a couple links as well. And we saw like some dramatic improvement within, I believe, 2 months of us doing this work. So it works really well. And it's definitely a tactic that you should consider. And it's one that, you know, allows you to get around a lot of the legal and compliance, because if anything, it's your legal and compliance reviewing one website and then buying the website. And that's pretty much it. So another common one, organization doesn't care about SEO. I feel for you deeply. I've been in that situation, you know, numerous times, whether it was someone that hired us and, you know, they're gung-ho about SEO and then the rest of the organization doesn't really care. I can tell you for a fact, you know, we worked with a very large e-commerce site that made billions of dollars annually from organic search, and they did not care about SEO. Like, they didn't care at all. So I feel for anyone that's in that position. But aside from quitting your job, it's really about education, it's about business cases, and it's about case studies. And again, you should use these algorithm updates as an opportunity to propel you towards getting things done. So if an algorithm update impacts the KPIs of the people in the organization that you need to get buy-in from, like for instance, Google is rolling out the core vitals thing and saying that it's gonna impact things moving forward. Well, if there's a engineering team or performance team that is judged around speed KPIs, you can now tie that directly to an upcoming Google update and say like, hey guys, we got to do this SEO stuff so that we can all be in alignment here and you guys don't get dinged when this algorithm update rolls out. And then the other thing is, don't be afraid to use vanity metrics to your advantage. You know, a lot of people that are C-level, they'll Google something and it'll be a query that doesn't matter at all. Like, you know, something that would just be like, okay, we want to rank for, I don't know, 3D TVs, right? And knowing that that keyword does not move the needle for us, it doesn't matter. You can get all the resources you need for what you need to do. And, you know, you can get the 3D TV keyword to rank better, but you can also use those resources on the rest of your SEO campaign. So we had a client that, you know, was really interested in featured snippets, and it became like a organization-wide focus. And, you know, we know that there is, of course, there's value in featured snippets, but the value changes, right? Like when Google made that recent update where featured snippets are now number one, it makes a lot more sense than it did at the onset when people were like, yeah, feature snippet. But we knew that we could get a lot of value out of getting them more feature snippets. And to do that would support a lot of the other things that we needed to do. So we anchored a lot of the work that we did around those feature snippets so we could get that buy-in and then get the things done that we wanted to get done. And just a note from our senior account manager, Chantel Branch. She says, be prudent with your words and data points. Executives tend to be very busy and prefer you to get to the bottom line as clearly and succinctly as possible. That's going to be true about any of these recommendations that we make around these ideas because, you know, you're talking about C-level people. They want to know the gist of things as soon as possible. They don't want to sit through your 50-slide deck. You're going to sit through my 50-slide deck right now, but they don't want to sit through that. They want to know what are the nuts and bolts of what we need to do. How does it affect me? What do you need? Give me the business case and let's make it happen. Another one is content deployment takes too long. You can't capitalize on news and trends. Again, I feel for you. That's a big struggle for large organizations. Definitely. It all comes down to content strategy. You know, I think in a lot of cases, you can be predictive around the things that you are going to want to do as a result of what the asks are for different clients and so on. And what happens in the marketplace, like, you know, holidays are coming up, you know, that you can create content around those holidays. So building out both a content calendar, the governance models and the workflows, and making sure you know who to talk to get these approvals, you can definitely get things going faster when you've got all those guardrails in place. And here's the thing, with all the process that can be very hindering to progress within these types of organizations, all that stuff drops down once it becomes very urgent from someone at the top. So when an urgent thing happens, you just got to make sure you're getting the buy-in from the right person, because suddenly everything will become very easy to get done. Obsolete technology and Frankenstein CMSs. Big problem that I see as well. You know, again, going back to this idea that you may have five different CMSs and, you know, you may be using an old version of the software where you can't deploy rel canonical tags and things of that nature. Well, in those cases, you can use a reverse proxy. We'll talk a bit more about reverse proxies later, but basically you can just get a CMS that is very usable, also Enterprise, WordPress, and then reverse proxy that into the site so that you can have more control and then get what you need to get done now. What about when brands have microsites? Well, microsites are usually a result of that previous problem. And then what happens is if you have all these microsites all over the place, well, you've got links going to all these different microsites, but it's not adding back to the bigger site. And those sites need to generate enough of their own links to be competitive to begin with. So what you need to do is just consolidate all those microsites into the core domain. And again, you can leverage a reverse proxy to do that, or you can just physically move those websites. What about the line of business thinking? Well, this is definitely a challenge, because when you've got, you know, the silo architecture of an organization where, you know, you've got one group, let's say it's like home insurance, another group, it's like auto insurance, and they're like, you know, we do what we do and that's that. And they think of their part of the website as a different website. But for Google, it's only one website. And so what that comes down to is lunch and learn sessions. You've got to get the key people from, and maybe not even like the most important people, but some people from those different lines of business, sit them down, get them pizza or whatever, and educate them as to why it's only one website from the perspective of Google. Another problem, they don't want to make SEO content because it's not what the audience wants. So first of all, that idea of SEO content is wrong, right? Like, this idea of you make content for search engines and not for people is an antiquated idea that comes from Google not really understanding content in the way that it does now. And Google has gotten dramatically more sophisticated around how they understand content. So it's very important that we align with that. And so Chris Hart, our director of revenue, has a great quote on this. He said, you just have to kind of help educate them that you're not just writing for a print product anymore. You're writing for a larger world thing, and then bring that all together. So again, there are expectations that search engines have. There's expectations that users have. And so there's also that overlap between the things. So you've got to account for what your brand is trying to say. You've got to account for what people are expecting and need to know. And then you also got to account for what search engines are expecting as well. And so it comes down to good content planning and doing effective road mapping. And so I think this Venn diagram explains it quite well. You know, you can do your content where you're just like creating things for your audience personas and your buyer personas. And that's going to be content that can be very effective, but it's not necessarily going to be content that's going to drive traffic. You can do it where you're just like, okay, what do my audience personas want? And also, what does search engines expect? That's going to drive traffic, that's going to get links and drive upper funnel, you know, opportunities and so on. But it's not going to drive content that's going to yield people buying. And you can do the same thing on the buyer personas, excuse me, and the search engine expectations. That's going to be performant lower funnel content. But again, it's not going to hit those upper funnel people that are going to yield links and so on. So you need to bring all those things together so that you can be effective in SEO. Now, what about in a siloed organization where the groups are just not communicating? And the way I think about that is like paid search versus organic search. Those teams never talk to each other. And what that comes down to is just internal networking, whether that's like you as an agency internal networking with your client or you as someone working in an enterprise networking with the client or with other people. And so the more you engage with folks, the more they're going to let you know what they're doing. And the more they're going to be like, oh, wait, you do this thing. You can help me out with this because I need this thing for this project. Otherwise, it's going to be, you know, at the end of the project or something's going to launch and you're not going to know about it. And then you're going to have to come back and clean it up. So it's all about knowing people and having people know you. And then there's the, you know, the ever-present problem of getting buy-in from engineers to actually implement things. So I can't speak enough about this because my background being computer science makes everything so much easier. Like I join standups, I join scrum meetings and things like that. And we talk about things from a very technical perspective as though I am an engineer on their team. Now, I'm not saying that everyone has to learn how to code, but it would be very valuable for everyone to learn to speak the product management language. So product managers are actually very similar to SEOs in that they have a wide variety of skills that they bring together to make a project happen from a technical perspective. And so they're, some level they're like project managers, on some level they're kind of like developers in that they know how things work. And they're also like QA engineers, so they understand when things are broken. But the thing that they do that's most interesting to me is they document what needs to be fixed. And the way that they documented it, or the way that they document it, is through user stories. And so typically when we do SEO and we do SEO recommendations, we just say, here's what's wrong and you should fix it. And you should probably fix it one of these ways, right? What engineers need is a detailed user story from the context of whether it's the search engine or the actual user and what the user is trying to accomplish. And then they also need the context of where these things are happening. And all that stuff just needs to be written in a way where a developer can pick it up and start working. If anything requires that they do additional thinking on top of like, how do they solve the problem from a coding perspective, those things are going to be delayed and they're not going to want to work on your stuff. So the more that you can act like a product manager and write those user stories and give them all the data that they need to make these things happen, the more likely that things are going to actually get implemented. So enterprise brands, typically very siloed. They don't really want to do anything new because they're already doing great. Yeah, that's a pretty big concern. You know, like they're like, hey, let's not rock the boat. Things are working. The best way to accomplish that or overcome that really would be through case studies, through business cases, and really showing what your competitors are doing. So again, we all know the 2 and 3 or 1 or 2 competitors in the space that are dominating everything. The more that you showcase like, oh, here's what such and such is doing. As an example, when I worked on LG, it was always like, well, what's Samsung doing? And as long as we could show Samsung was doing it, LG would do it too. So you just got to show, you know, those business cases and then show why it's more valuable for them to do it. So as far as our approach for enterprise SEO, you know, the way that we look at this, and everything starts on strategic planning. We want to understand what it is that a given business is doing and why they're doing it. Understand the users and their journeys. Who's that user behind the visit? From there, we move into content strategy, you know, really understanding what it is that needs to be created, what can be repurposed, who are the people creating things and so on. And then we move into the technical development. That's where we would do things like site auditing and so on, so we can figure out what's going on under the hood. Once we've got content deployed and it's working and it's accessible and everything is linked properly, then we move into promotions, whether that is, you know, link building or content promotion to attract links and so on. We do all of that. Then we move into measurement, although measurement technically starts during the strategic planning phase, where we're trying to make sure we're measuring the right things the right way. And then we're optimizing further, whether that is like specific A/B tests around SEO or even CRO, or just big picture thinking of like, how do we iterate on what we're doing so we get more value out of it? So as far as how that translates into deliverables and their dependencies, everything for us starts from that customer segmentation. So we go from those personas and we use that to inform both our content auditing and our keyword research. And then from there, once we've got those things done, we move on to the site audits and also our competitive analysis. Once that wave of stuff done, we can move into the findings from the audit and turn that to a content plan. We do our measurement planning, and then we also build what we call an SEO copy brief, which kind of acts as a style guide between SEO and content strategy. And then we also do a backlink audit so we can figure out like what kind of spam is already in there, what do we need to disavow, where can we get more links, and so on. And so all of our planning and discovery is done at this point, and then we move into the actual execution. So when I talk to you guys about, technical content optimization and how we're using natural language processing to optimize things, that is done in what we call our content recommendations. That's us making adjustments to existing content. Then we create a content calendar or a production calendar. We start creating content and we're developing it and deploying it. And then we also do implementation audits to make sure that the things that we recommended to our clients actually get done. And those act as a very important instrument for us to push things through, because we'll give a bunch of recommendations and people forget about them or things will change. And so we've got to go back and say like, wait, don't forget about this stuff because it's important. And of course, we're doing reporting at that point. And every quarter, we're also doing quarterly business reviews so that we, again, can further optimize the campaign and get more out of what we're doing. So this is the core of what we do when we're doing enterprise SEO. But we may bring in things for like social media and machine learning, and we may do CRO, and we basically bolt on those other components as required based on the needs for our clients. So some strategies and tactics you should think about employing if you haven't already. On the strategy side, one, business cases. You've got to build effective business cases. And the way I always think about these is largely about how do we do it from an opportunity cost perspective. So an example of one, I worked on a client a few years ago where they had 12 million links pointing to 302 redirects. And, I know Google will say there's no difference between 302s and 301s, but ultimately, once we did this business case and they actually made that change, there was a dramatic improvement in organic search visibility and traffic. So there's that. But what we did for the business case was say, okay, for these 12 million links, if you were to pay an SEO agency to build these links for you, here's what it would cost. And that number was astronomical, right? But putting a number like that to something that they're effectively wasting made it more of a priority to them. And then they ultimately did implement that recommendation. So I would recommend that you think about like whether it's showing that value in terms of the opportunity cost of paid search versus organic for some recommendations, or looking to put a dollar value on the things that they're not doing and putting that in front of your clients or your internal clients to make sure things will actually happen. You got to find your internal champion as well. So both whether you work at an organization or you're on the agency side, you've got to figure out who can actually push things through for you and give you all the information that you need to make things happen. And then competitive intelligence. I can't tell you how many times that people have been like, hey, we're not doing this thing. And as soon as I show what a competitor is doing, they're like, oh, maybe we should do this thing. So you should always like use tools like Search Metrics or SEM Rush and pull those data points, also show those things qualitatively on the site, and you're more able to get buy-in that way. And then workflows and governance models, incredibly important. Again, you've got to map things out so that everyone knows what needs to be done. You got to figure out who all the key players are, and then also work with them to adjust those governance models and those workflows such that they can be more conducive to making things happen. So you can have a specific workflow for a piece of content that is urgent, and that can be different from your standard workflow. So it may not need to go through all the same approvals, or it may not need to have, certain type of imagery that's always required. Whatever that is, you need to document that so you can just be like, hey guys, we got to run the ghost protocol today so that we can, you know, get this content live. But you've got to do that before those types of things come up, because otherwise you're just going to be stuck going through those standard procedures because of the fact that, you know, you don't have those other models in place. Content strategy. I don't know how anybody can do SEO in general without content strategy, but I think that, especially if you're in the enterprise, it's an absolute requirement. And so the way it's defined by the brain traffic team really breaks it down into the substance and structure of content. And then there's also the people side of it, those workflows and those governance models. And I would encourage you to just learn more about content strategy as a discipline. But again, when you're thinking about content creation, it's got to be at that intersection of what the brand wants and what the audience wants. It can't just be, oh, hey, we're the brand putting something out and now you got to go optimize it. You always have to exist at that intersection. And then you got to think about, like, how do we operationalize this? So SEO needs to be baked into it across the board. It can't just be like, okay, we did some content, press the SEO button, all right, we're done. Like, no. Again, you've got to have it built into the governance models and how people are working through the creation of this content to account for these things. It can't just be done the content, hand it to the SEO, now put it out. Like, no, you've got to be thinking about this early on. And then strategically, you got to be thinking about doing lunch and learns. People love to eat for free. And they also love to, you know, learn about things that can help them be better at their jobs, especially if it doesn't necessarily require them to do anything but reach out to you. So the more that you get in with your clients, internal or external, if you're an agency, and spend the time to educate them, give them POVs on what's happening, the more they're going to bring you in to actually get these things done. And then cross-channel alignment is incredibly important. Again, it's very easy for for SEO to come in and disrupt things. You've got to figure out the best way to align with the marketing mix already. And from there, you can always, you know, drive better value and also have better conversations with people. If you're just talking about keywords and links and meta tags, other people on the team are going to zone out. But if you can have the conversation at the market segment level and then talk about how organic search can support that, you're going to get a lot more buy-in. Integrated search, something that doesn't really happen in practice. A lot of people talk about it, but, you know, the more that you can engage with the people on the paid search side in your organization or at your client, the more effective you're going to be, because you have the opportunity to test and learn things and also find more efficiencies between both channels. So you, of course, will see the halo effect of being visible in both, but at the same time, you can also allow them to shift their monies into places that organic search is not effective, where, you know, they're wasting it on places that organic search is effective. And finally, I need you to think like a product manager. Again, embracing those agile methodologies, writing user stories, getting comfortable having detailed conversations with your engineering teams, you're going to be way more effective at pushing things through. So let's talk real quick about a couple of tactics. I want to save a few minutes for any questions that have come through. Natural language generation. I wrote a blog post about this on Search Engine Journal recently about how you can use GPT-2 and also GPT-3 to generate copy for pages that's actually viable and valuable, freeing up your copywriters to spend more time on the creative aspects rather than writing copy for pages that, you know, no one really actually wants to write or read. Automated 301 redirection of broken links. So, you know, using the Ahrefs API on the broken links and grabbing that data, excuse me, programmatically, and then implementing 301 redirects. I would encourage you to also leverage the NLP API for this so that you can get the entities associated with the source page, like the old page that you're replacing, and then match it up with the entities on other pages so that Google definitely forwards that link equity. Automated testing, incredibly important for getting people to, on your engineering teams, to not break SEO in the future. When you get them to fix anything, you can also put these safeguards in the form of tests. So when they deploy things in the future, they just don't break because they're not allowed to deploy things if the tests don't work. Log file analysis, I can't say enough about that. Like, there's just so many insights that you can get out of it. And in fact, you know, especially when you're thinking about a bigger site, The faster the site is, the more Google is going to crawl it. And you can learn from your log files, like where those opportunities are. How long is Google taking to download pages specifically on a URL level? And so Botify is a great tool for really understanding that. Internal link building, incredibly important. Like I said, eBay does this really well. You can do this programmatically, especially for a bigger site. So you can flow that link equity to pages that you want to rank better. And I would encourage you to do that. It's one of the most valuable assets that you have. And then reverse proxies. You know, the way those work is basically you configure a server to sit in front of another server and get the pages from that server and then show them at a URL of your choosing. So what that means is that a server can live somewhere else, but still look like it's on your site. If you think about Google, right? If you go to Google Photos, or if you go to like Google Calendar or whatever, that lives at slash calendar, but it's not the same exact machine that is serving you from Google Search. And I know that ultimately that turns into subdomains and so on, but they have URLs that live in the subdirectory structure. And so despite the fact that it's multiple machines, it looks like it's one machine to you. And then again, domain acquisition, so valuable with respect to link building when you can't actually build links or if you need to build links fast. So quick word from our sponsor, check out our movie. We made a SEO movie called Runtime. We would recommend you watch it because it's amazing. And you know, if you want more information on the things that I discussed today, check out our Enterprise SEO ebook as well. And also our Forecasting and Measuring SEO ROI ebook. And with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen so I can see you guys and see what questions you have. Right. Cool. What questions we got? All right, ask a question. Home Depot. How do they prevent their local pages from becoming doorway pages? Is it because they have a physical address for that location? Not really sure how to answer that one, but I'm going to try. So I think when we say doorway pages, it's more like these pages are not valuable. They're just like a page with a little bit of copy on it that is meant for you to go to another page. And that's not how Home Depot's local landing pages work. Their pages are very robust pages that are meant to be landing pages where you can get all the information you need to know about Home Depot and just go from there. So I don't think they're considered doorway pages in that case. So you don't really have to worry about that. How can someone get started on A/B testing for SEO? Well, if you just want to try it out, you know, you can use Google Tag Manager to set up some A/B tests. And we talk about that on the Runtime landing page. So you can check that out on how you can get that set up. There's also a variety of posts out there where people talk about doing it. But you can also check out a few different tools out there. So there is Rank Science. There's also Search Pilot, which is Distill's tool. And there's a couple other tools out there, including a couple that are on the way that I don't want to talk about because I don't think I'm allowed to. But anyway, start there. And again, the Distill team has put out a lot of information in the space about SEO A/B testing. So I just encourage you to check those out and read that stuff because they've got some really detailed methodologies around it. Key thing to know, though, is that you're testing on page buckets rather than splitting your traffic like 50% like you would do for a CRO test. And these methodologies really came from companies like Etsy and Pinterest, and they've all blogged about it publicly about what their approach has been and so on. So I would encourage you to read up on all that stuff. And in some of my previous presentations, I've linked out to that stuff as well. So I'd encourage you to check that out too. All right. Large client is frequently setting the pace for us since we're still learning their internal governance. How can we set the pace? How can we start telling them what they need rather than vice versa? Well, yeah, I think that is a really tricky situation where, like you said, the client is leading. I think it really comes from a level set where you sit down with them and say, all right, we got to document what this governance model looks like. Like, we need to know all the pieces here because we need to be effective. And at that point, once you've all like documented it, you've got like diagrams or on a whiteboard, or maybe not a whiteboard because you're not going to see anybody in person for another year. But anyway, once you've got it documented, it's just like anything else, you can then optimize it. So you can say, all right, well, we got these steps and all these people that we need to speak to. This isn't really working in these different areas. And here's what we recommend doing so that we can be effective. And they may balk at that. And what you then say is like, all right, well, let's test it out for a piece of content or for an optimization or whatever. And then, you know, you do your best on that test. And then once it works out, you can say, okay, well, this worked better than the other way, effectively A/B testing it. And then you can say, well, let's try this moving forward. So it's really about getting everybody to stop and come to a consensus, and then come to a consensus of what we're going to do moving forward. How can you set up programmatic internal link building? Are there tools for this? To my knowledge, there are no tools that do it the way that I was describing with respect to how eBay does it. It's really like an engineering task. And there's a blog post that I think I linked to on the runtime landing page, or will, or, you know, we'll share it, from a gentleman named Dennis G. I can never say his last name right. When he was at eBay, they built this whole appliance, so to speak, that basically checks rankings. And then if a landing page ranks in, you know, the 11 through 20 space, they build a bunch of links internally to that page, and then it pops up onto page one. So it's not the type of thing I can really explain in depth, like right this second on, you know, in like 2 minutes. But I would encourage you to check out Dennis's post. His website is called thenextcorner.com. And that's also his Twitter handle, nextcorner. So yeah, definitely check that out and you'll get a better understanding, but it's definitely something that you gotta give your engineering team to actually pull off. So cool. No more questions. I just want to thank everybody for tuning in today. And yes, of course, we will send out these slides. And like I said, it's a 6-year anniversary for iPullRank. So we're excited for all of you to continue to engage with us. And yeah, thanks so much for your time. See you on the next one.